Jesus, we thank you.
Thank you for the way that you loved us, how you love us. Thank you for the way how you love us, how you love us.
Lord, we thank you. Faithful God,
you've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. And your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things.
Sing it to him.
God, you do great things. Oh, hero of Bethlehem, you have your great day. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. For Jesus, I see you, your name is in I, oh God.
Hallelujah, through him.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Oh, sing it again.
Hallelujah, God. Have done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We thank you for freedom, awaken. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, who lives in my life. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
He has done great things in our midst and in our lives. Let's praise God, for his love never fails. Let's praise him.
Nothing can separate, even if I ran away, 'cause your love never fails.
love of our God. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. Comes in the morning, and when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. Come on, all together. The wind is strong and the water's deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas. Your love never fails. The chasm is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side. Your love never fails. You say the same. You say the same to the angels. Because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. It does. We can rest on this promise. Sing it to him. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. To the goat of those who love the Lord. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You say, you say the same. Wonderful thing that in spite of it all, in spite of the storms that we see surrounding us or in our lives, the promise is that to those who love the Lord, He makes all things work together for His good. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Come on. worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Let's sing Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say worthy. Lord, this is our prayer tonight, that as you have loved us, we will love one another for your glory and honor. Let's sing Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who ever said, worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever say, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. We sing, holy,
there is no one like you.
No one beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are. And I will build my life upon your love.
morning, church. Today's reading will be found in Luke 6, verses 27 to 36, and 1 John 4, verse 7 to 8. But to you who are listening, I say, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, turn to them the other also. If someone takes your coat, do not withhold your shirt from them. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. 1 John 4, 7 to 8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is the reading of God's word. You may all be seated.
Good morning. I'd like you to take out your four W's, because we will be having our discipleship group after this worship service and announcements, and we will basically take up all the points here. Pastor TJ mentioned a while ago the topic is love difficult people, and he said, I hope jokingly, that his wife considers him a difficult person. Am I right? Am I drawing that conclusion, or am I stretching it, Pastor TJ? Your wife considers you a difficult person, right? You consider yourself. You consider yourself a difficult person. Okay, I should stand corrected. Well, I guess we're in the same boat, huh? My wife tells me that, although I consider myself a good person. But I'm deluded, no? I'm in self-denial sometimes. I am a difficult person, simply because I do see myself as what you might call that, as somebody who tries to do what is right, okay? Let me put it that way. And the effective word there is try. Pastor TJ, do you try to do what is right for your wife? He's too far for me to hold the conversation. So do you try to show to do what's right for your wife? And do you fail? Every day, okay. For me, it's not just every day, but every moment of the day. No, it's like I try, but nothing is good enough. Not that I'm venting. I'm just saying we all have different expectations of each other. And I guess that goes the opposite way, too. I have my own expectations. Pastor Tanchi actually said that to avoid being disappointed or discouraged about another person is to lower your expectations. Right? Lower your expectations and, what's the other word he said? Lower your expectations so that you will not be discouraged with the other person. I guess that's a good first principle in terms of how you deal with difficult people. And the most difficult person to live with is yourself. How many of you agree? Okay, very good. We all agree. Pastor Tanchi gave this illustration. I like the illustration because it's closer to home. He said he went to New York City, and he likes going to zoos, different zoos around the world. He went to the New York Zoo. Would that be the one in Central Park? I don't know, maybe there are other zoos, but I've never been to a zoo in New York. There's a Bronx Zoo, which I hear a lot of good things about. Now, where is the zoo where you go into this sort of tunnel, and you it says the most dangerous animal in the world. The most dangerous animal in the world. You go in there, and you expect to see something really fierce, but at the end of the tunnel, you see a mirror. No? And he goes, what? The most dangerous animal is me. It's right there, looking at me. Okay, I don't know if you would agree to that. But G.K. Chesterton, the famous British columnist, wrote something on his editorial. He's actually a Christian. And he said in response to somebody who asked him, what is wrong with the world, Mr. Chesterton? And he answered, it's me. Huh? What is wrong with the world is me. My wife, who's lived with me for 40 years, longer than I've lived without her, because I'm now 60, so 25 years living without her and 40 years with her, is something that makes me, I would say, prepared to live with difficult people. Because when you live with somebody that long, almost 24/7, and she's lived with me for 40 years, so she's learned how to deal with a difficult person. She doesn't see me, and I don't see her in 1D. You know what 1D is? Flat. One dimension, flat. She sees me, and I see her in 3D. Huh? What do you mean by that, Pastor? I mean that I can see different facets of her. I can see different pictures of her. You see me, and perhaps you don't know me that well. You only see me as a pastor. Huh? But if you are often with me, and if you're often with me, I'm often with my wife, and you see my wife with me, you see me as a husband. Okay? And if you see me with my children, well, I guess I only have Cherise here, for which you can be with me if you are with me and she's with me, you will see me as a father. Make sense? In order to deal with difficult people, to you, who is a difficult person, maybe that person is difficult for you because you see them only in 1D. In one dimension. Does that make sense? Okay, why am I emphasizing this? I heard a podcast by four pastors, and they were talking to each other. And the four pastors were saying, how do you deal with a difficult member in your church? And all four of them agreed that the way to deal with them is to spend more time with them. Because the more time you spend with a person, the more you get to know the person, and the more the person gets to know you. That as a pastor, you're just like a human being like them. And as a pastor, you know that your members are going through difficult periods in their life. All right? I say this because over the years that I've been your pastor, I have spent a lot of time with some of you and some of your families, and I see what you're going through. I know the struggles you face. I know what it means for you to cry when you're alone. And to me, that makes me understand you in a way that I don't prejudge you. I don't say you're this or you're that. I see your life as contributing to why you're acting in a certain way or why you're reacting in a certain way. This morning, our Lord Jesus Christ repeated some of the things that he's been saying in the earlier times of his stay here with us. And if you open your Bibles to Luke chapter 6, you will find these words. And I'd like to go through each verse. I want you to understand everything that he says here, because if you do, you will learn to love your enemies. All right? This has spoken to me before I speak this to you. Why enemies? Is your spouse your enemy when you have difficulties? No. But the word enemy in Greek has to do with somebody who is hostile, who is actively hostile to you. So when I speak to my wife and she reacts, or when she speaks to me, this goes both ways. Don't just think my wife is just the difficult person, but I am too. And we deal with our difficulties in many ways. Some of you, I know, instead of confronting the difficulty, you run away. No? It's better to just turn your back, walk away. Sorry, I don't want to deal with this. But oftentimes, you can't avoid but face a difficult situation, isn't it? How many of you agree? I'm glad you do. And you can sympathize with me that it's difficult. It's never easy. Because every situation that presents itself, and that doesn't apply to us and husband and wife only, it applies to people who live in the same household, people who work together in the workplace, and even people you come across in the street, no? Vendors, and the like. And you have had that experience. You've seen vendors who are difficult to deal with. You're trying to haggle over the price, and the person just looks at you and with an odd look, and you're just trying to get the best, most for your money. I'm talking about the Philippines. I don't think you can haggle for the price when you go into a grocery store here, right? You can't go, can I have that for 50 cents instead of 65? No, you can't do that. But in the Philippines, you can. Right? In some most Asian countries. You find difficult people everywhere. And people find you difficult also everywhere you go. Just yesterday, we went to Chipotle, my wife and I. And I was in line, and we liked Chipotle, but we shared the same burrito bowl, no? Because it's too much. And when I saw the lady putting in the stuff, and I said, wow, look at that. She filled it to the brim and almost overflowing. I said, I want that too, right? The problem is when I get to the front of the line and she goes, which rice? What are your choice? White rice or brown rice? I'm not promoting Chipotle by any means, right? It's just that our favorite. My wife likes brown rice. Nah? So I said, brown rice. And she goes, no more. I look at the container and there's still some left. Nah? But because I want to make her happy, I said, can you get that what's left there? And she gives me a big pout. Nah? And it takes her a while to get it because she has to scrape it from the bottom. And we only got a little bit. We didn't get as much as the ones before. So strike one. I already know she found me difficult. Okay? Because I just wanted what's best for my wife. Brown rice is healthier. No, and I believe that too. So as I go down the line, I ask, can you put, what's that, sour cream on the side? She doesn't. No? She doesn't do it. So anyway, I know there's another lady who's in the cashier, and she's waiting there. And she goes, okay, what else do you want? I said, I want some sour cream. She tells the other woman again, can you get him some sour cream? Guess what? She doesn't, okay? But this lady who was so nice and so very pleasing, with a very pleasant personality, she gets it herself and gives it to me. After all that, I came back to the cashier and I said, can I have your name and how can I give a good feedback for you? Because you helped me get what I want. She was so happy and thrilled. In fact, she said, oh, yes, my name is Elise Geniza and this is the website that you should go to. So what happened there? No? There's somebody who obviously found me difficult, but there's somebody else who found me okay. No? In fact, was happy to do as I had, and I was able to give her something that pleased her, right? Made her happy. What did I miss to do? What did I miss doing? Notice how I ignored the first lady. Not the first lady, as the first lady of the U.S., no? The first one that I encountered. I ignored her. I said, you're a difficult person. I'm not going to deal with you. I'm going to deal with somebody who can accommodate me. Is that bad? Most of you will say no. That's just natural. You know, maybe she's not having a good day, and you don't want to have a good day yourself, right? Those are the justification we make. But Jesus says, love your enemies. Do good to those who insult you, who persecute you. And now if you read that verse, the verse is there. Why? Why should I do that? Every ounce of energy and thought in me is saying, don't do it. Don't waste your time on that blah, blah, blah person. No? She's not worth it. Now, I say this because all of us face that kind of situation day in and day out, maybe even in church, no? Where we are confronted with people who find us difficult, and we find sometimes difficult as well. That's a reality of life, because we see each other in just one dimension. That lady, the first lady, did not see that I was doing it for my wife. In fact, I even told her, I'm sorry, I want some brown rice because my wife likes brown fried rice. And I mean, it's not brown fried rice, brown rice, right? Fried rice is only the Chinese. Okay, shops. Am I making sense? No? I want to show her that I'm not after her. I'm after something that will benefit somebody else, or maybe more than one person. No? Maybe there's somebody else who might want brown rice. Can you go check at the back? Maybe they're still making it, or something like that. I'm laboring on this because this is what I learned from this passage. Let's read together, 6:27. It says here, but I say to you who hear. Now, in the Bible, when it says hear, it implies those who hear and obey. Huh? It's not just, nakikinig ka ba? Are you listening? In Filipino, when we say, nakikinig pero hindi naman ginagawa, no? They hear but they don't obey, especially children, right? Oh, my child, he doesn't obey. Which means, well, he doesn't listen. Which means he doesn't obey. Hear and obey is what it's saying. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. How many things are you supposed to do for your enemies? Count. Love, do good, bless, and pray. You would think, one is enough. If I have an enemy, I'll just do one. Pray for that person, hoping that I may never have to do any business with that person again. How do you bless somebody who curses you? Well, you keep doing good. You keep doing good, because that's what do good implies. You do good, you bless, you keep doing good to that person because you want the best for that person. That's what love is. This is love in action. It's not an emotion. Oh, I love that difficult person. I really do. I feel something for him. I have pity for why he's like that or she's like that. You won't score any points with that. Because the next verse simply says, 28. Well, let me just add some more. Because the Lord Jesus piles it on. He piles it on. By the way, which book is this from? Luke, right? Luke. Where do you find this as well. Where do you find all of these things about loving your enemies? Which book? Aside from Luke. In Matthew. In what sermon? Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 5 and 6. Maybe even 7. So 5 and 6, starting with blessed are the poor in spirit, that's the Beatitudes. I'm just trying to look back on that. Now, by the way, do you know what this sermon is called in Luke? If Matthew is called Sermon on the Mount, what is this sermon on the called? Blank. It's called Sermon on the Plains. Okay? Sermon on the Plains. So if Jesus did a Sermon on the Mount, Jesus did a Sermon on the Plain. Is it one and the same sermon? Maybe, maybe not. In fact, Sermon on the Mount could have been a collection of Jesus' sayings. Why is it important to interpret this one different from the first one? See, Matthew was written to who? Who was Matthew's audience? To Jews. Whereas Luke is writing to the Gentiles. What's the difference? Matthew was speaking to people who knew the law, who are familiar with Moses and the prophets and all that. But the Gentiles, who are new believers, because they're not Jews, a lot of things they don't understand. So Luke is longer than Matthew. In fact, it's the longest book in the Bible, in the New Testament. Now, all of these background. Luke was writing to strengthen our faith. Matthew was writing also to strengthen our faith, but more so to say Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. You understand? There are some new things here that aren't in Matthew. Why? Because the Gentiles needed to understand something more than just what is stated in the Old Testament. Have a look at this. 28. Verse 28. Bless those who... 29. Whoever hits you on the cheek. Remember this one? In Matthew? How many of you remember the sermon I gave on Matthew? On whoever strikes you on the cheek. You do? Now, you remember my acting... It's not an Oscar award winning acting, but how is the slapping characterized, or how is it described in Matthew? If somebody slaps you on the right cheek, no? What's wrong with that? To a Jew, somebody slapping on the right cheek is an insult, is a big insult. And to a Gentile, they don't get that. No? In fact, in this verse, let me just get a drink of water. To a Gentile, this is unheard of. It's not only an insult, it's actually an event that can cause you to take out your gun and shoot your enemy. To a Hebrew, to a Jew, there's room for forgiveness. No? But Gentiles, you know, well, I guess to the Jews, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and all that, no? Can also be taken. But they have a special dispensation with people who slaps you. It's not a capital punishment. Why am I mentioning this? If somebody slaps you, imagine, what is your first reaction? Slap back. Slap back, revenge. Yeah, of course, that's but ordinary. Or some Filipino movies. Why did you do that? That's usually the storyline, isn't it? But ginawa yun? You want an explanation. You want an explanation. And slapping back is not enough. You want to know, why did you slap me? Right? Am I making sense? Why do you think we say that? I don't know if you've ever been slapped as a child. I've never slapped my children, although I've been tempted to, because I know that if you touch somebody's face, according to psychologists, you have devalued that person. Now you have made him of no value. I'm trying to understand this because the way I see this slapping in Filipino movies, you know, and slap left and right, no? So many scenes like that. When I was growing up, I hated going to, what's her name? You forced me once to go with you. Huh? Sharon Cuneta. No? Kailan, no? Luluhod na langit? Bukas, no? Hindi kailan. Bukas, luluhod ng mga langit. Tomorrow, the stars will kneel. Direct. Tala nga, tala. Luluhod ng tala. Yes, sorry. Langit. No? What is that movie about again? I'm just getting sidetracked a bit here because Sharon Cuneta is a poor, defenseless person against this rich...
Sherry Hill,
she still remembers. I fell asleep. I actually fell asleep during that movie. Because I wasn't fond of seeing slapping left and right, no? But the point I'm saying is this. The point I'm making is this. We want to understand because when somebody slaps us, even as a child, you feel like your rights have been violated. Am I right? Is that your reaction? Your reaction is, although I'm a child, I also have my rights as a child. You cannot just slap me. I'm beginning to feel like perhaps some of you have slapped your children, and I'm sure you have repented of it. But if a child gets himself to be older and he starts to assert his rights, wouldn't the child say, I have a right to defend myself? I have a right to say that what you did was wrong. I'm not going to go into that because that's the way of the world. That's the way a normal human being would react. That my rights have been violated, especially here in America. If your rights are violated, take him to court. Sue him. So if your parents slap you, sue your parents. And again, I'm scaring some of you because you might have, but the point is not that we should do that. The point is, as a believer, Jesus is saying, if somebody slaps you on one cheek, turn to them the other also. Are Christians masochists? Sige pa. No? More. You did it? More. Now, that's not what it means. If I were you, if somebody slaps you, I'll avoid that. You run away, so he doesn't slap you anymore, isn't it? You're not going to stand there and say, slap me on the other. But you're not going to also fight back. Why? Because he says, turn the other cheek also. In other words, the point is, if someone violates your rights, don't stand up for your rights. Be willing to give it up. You follow? Be willing to give up your rights. And not to retaliate against such a hostile act. And that's why Christians, when they were being persecuted, in the first century, they were being killed for their faith. The second century, did not retaliate, did not assert their rights. Because to strike means that somehow it's insulting for a non-Jewish audience like the audience of Luke. It signifies a taking away of a right. But look, he continues. Jesus piles it on, so to speak. Not only slapping, but this time it says, someone takes your coat. What does that mean? Someone takes your coat. He rubs it. He takes your coat. If someone takes your coat, what does he say? Don't withhold the other, your shirt from them. The old translation says tunic, the inner or inner clothing. Okay, what does that mean? Someone robs you. No? And you say, why did you take this? That's the usual reaction, right? You have no right because that's my personal property. You say then, take this as well. You see, Matthew has a different way of putting it. If somebody brings a suit against you, somebody brings you to court for your clothes, for instance, very very flimsy things, then you would also in that same court say, I'm okay, take my coat as well. So the reverse, no? Why the reverse? A lot of scholars are puzzled by this. It simply means that whatever the order is somebody still taking something that belongs to you, right? That's interesting, because if something belongs to you, you will fight for it. That's like the incident I told you about, this young lady walking through a Bronx park, no, Morningside Park, and did not want to give her cell phone, right? I don't mean to say that was what she did was wrong, but then here's this illustration. Give him your, they want your cell phone? Here, take my cell phone. I'll give you my watch too. That goes with the phone. You see the illustration? Because I can't use this. I can't use this phone. I mean, I can't use this watch anymore because my phone is missing. It links to the phone. Does that make sense? I remember Les Miserables. And now this is a very famous scene. Jean Valjean steals the candlesticks, or is it the fork and spoon? Oh, he takes this fork and silverware first, right? Silverware first, forks and spoon, I think. Jean Valjean, the ex-convict. Now listen to this, it's a nice story. If you have a chance to watch it, it's full of Christian meanings. From the church, because he was taken in by the priest. He was taken in and the priest was asleep. Jean Valjean said, this will do nicely so I can start a new life. He takes the silverware. The police catch him. Javert, right? Javert catches him. And Javert says to the priests, did this man steal the silverware from you? And the priest says, no, I gave it to him. And then the priest goes to the candlesticks in the kitchen as well. And he hands it over to Jean Valjean, the ex-convict, and says, friend, my friend, you forgot these. That illustrates this verses. Not only did the priest show mercy, Jean Valjean deserved to go to jail. Javert was ready to take him away. Javert was looking for an excuse to put him back in prison, to find something wrong with that man. But the priest says, no. Gave him the candlestick. That's an illustration of grace. He doesn't deserve the candlestick because he's already stolen. Why give him the candlestick? He has enough to start, perhaps. But out of the goodness of his heart, he gives the candlesticks and says, you forgot to take this as well. That's grace. You see the difference? Mercy is not getting what is deserved, and grace is getting what you don't deserve. Okay? If somebody takes your coat, give to him your tunic also. Mercy, grace. Isn't that what the whole gospel is about? we have rebelled and disobeyed the God of this universe, the Creator, the God who loves us. But what do we get in return? We get His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We don't get punishment and death for our disobedience. Instead, we get forgiveness of our sins and life everlasting. Do you see, my dear brothers and sisters, the clear illustration of this passage? You don't assert your rights with God because you know that God is merciful to you, but not just you. Later we'll find out He's merciful to everyone. And He's telling you to be merciful as well, to be forgiving, to be kind. I know sometimes we see each other as being unforgiving. My wife sees me as that many times, and I see her also like that. We see each other every day, 24/7, as not being merciful, not being gracious, not being kind. I'm sorry, but I want to point out this is a long way from being nice. No? Some of you think that Christianity is about being nice. If somebody is not nice to you, does that mean that person is not kind to you? You know, not necessarily. Because niceness is often in your own perception. It's subjective. But kindness is God's character and therefore a fruit of the Spirit. Okay? I say this because I often hear people say, he's not being nice and so he's not a believer. He's not forgiving, so he doesn't practice what he preaches. Are we making such judgments because we see only one side of the person? We only see what we can see, but we don't see other things that happen to that person as well. One of our counselees, Celia, told me one time, said, I told her, I think, one of the things that our counselees see with us is we don't judge. I'm not trying to put myself high on a pedestal. I'm just telling you that this is the sort of attitude you should have with people you counsel, people you advise. If you are so high up there that you think that everything the person does is wrong and therefore should be corrected, then you might have a second thought about that. Because you might have to read the Beatitudes again. You see, Corinthians talks about this too. Do not bring a lawsuit against a brother in court. Don't we have the church with its leaders to judge such matters? And what do you have, what do you gain by bringing a suit against somebody? Asserting your rights, but at the end of the day, breaking up the relationship and the fellowship. My wife and I were tempted at one point that when somebody wrote a letter that was very slanderous, to bring this to court. But then we thought it out and said, would we not be witnessing to the goodness of God if we did that? And putting the world's judgment before God's judgment. You see? God's judgment is far better than the world's. But even more significant is the verse that follows, verse 30. What does verse 30 say? Look at it. In your four W's, it's there. Give to everyone who asks you, and whoever takes away what is yours, do not demand it back. If somebody takes away your dignity, your good name, don't demand it back. treat others the same way. That's the next verse. That's a golden rule, isn't it? But it's put in a more positive way. Most of the golden rules, like Confucius, it says, do not treat others the way you do not want them to treat you. This is positive. This is love in action. And it's not just saying, oh, don't treat somebody the way they are treating you. I'll just lie back here, chill. No. Be positive and do what is good. I'd like to wind it up with the next verses. Verse 32 asks these questions. What kind of question is this? When you are asked this question, can you give an answer? It's a rhetorical question. You can't answer it. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Because you know the answer already. If you love only those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love him. See, Christianity is radical. It's turning the world upside down. It's saying, you don't just associate yourself with others who can treat you nicely. You expose yourself to others whom you might end up, becoming your enemy, becoming hostile to you. I know of someone who actually did this and went out of his way to befriend somebody who, you can just ignore. He doesn't know that person. He just wanted to be able to have a relationship with that person so that he can treat others so that there's no credit back to you. When you say credit, by the way, the Jews have a different understanding of this, but us as Gentiles do. Some people think this is like credit. No? What is credit? That means you will get more than what you gave back. Right? It's not karma. Because karma is you give something, do something, and something will come back to you. But here, is credit means you do something, and you get more than what you put in. You invested, in other words. That's precisely what this last part is about. It's saying that when you love those who don't love you, you're getting more in return. Let's look at that. How can we get return if we love those who don't love us? Okay, next verse. Hear this. It adds, for even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners in order to receive back the same amount. Notice it says the same amount. So what do you think credit means when you lend someone to someone? Interest, right? When you lend to someone, and if you are after credit back to you, you don't just lend and get back the same amount. You're familiar with this? I don't know, 5-6, but no? In the Philippines, we have what we call 5-6. And for those, the younger people, this means the interest is 20%. That's so much, isn't it? It's usury. It's illegal, right? But these are done underhandedly. Anyway, not too much on that. Expecting to be repaid in full. In full. That means the principal plus interest. Do you follow? Are you getting the economics of this? The world's economics is like this. I give, I expect something more in return. Why? Because I could have put that money in the bank and it could have earned interest, so you give me interest for what I give you. Jesus is saying, if you lend to those who you expect repayment for, what credit is that to you? You lend so that you don't get it back. If you don't get it back, you don't feel bad. That's what a Christian is supposed to do. And some of you are already asking, That's impossible. Look at the next verse. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting what? Nothing in return. Because then, here is the conclusion to the matter. If you love your enemies, if you do good to them, if you bless them, if you pray for them, if you give to them your inner shirt, your tunic, when they steal your coat, if you lend without expecting any return, then, what does it say? Your reward will be great in heaven. Does that mean you will get the interest in heaven? That's the principle. Does that mean you'll get a bigger mansion? Some people say. Far from it. The verse says, what is the reward? What is the reward? And you will be children of the Most High. And you will be children of the Most High. Look at that. Does that mean if I love my enemies, if I pray for them, do good to them, bless them, and I give them, if they steal from me, I give them everything much more as well, and if I lend, I don't expect any return, does that mean I will get to go to heaven because of all these things I have done? No, that's what the whole Bible is saying. It's not because you've done something good that God will reward you eternal life because of your goodness. What does the Bible always say? For God so loved the world, He gave. He's the one who gave. We have nothing to give. We only have to believe in what He gave. Do you follow? We only have to repent of our sin and turn to God. Okay. The word there is, then you will show that you are children of God. Then you will prove that you are children of God. Then you will have the fruit of the Spirit in you. Drum roll. I wish Jim was here. He can do a pretty mean drum roll. Can you do it without the drums? Some people can click their tongues like it's a drum. But drum roll. Because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Who is the ungrateful and the wicked? And everybody said, can you continue the sentence? We are. Say it louder, please. We are the ungrateful and the wicked. Don't anyone say, God loves me because I am a good person. Don't anyone say, God loves me because I treat my neighbors right. What should we say in that instead? God loves me because He chose to love me even though I am ungrateful and wicked. As we celebrate the Lord's Supper, this is the illustration of how God loves us. This is His love in action. He gave. He prayed. Jesus prayed for us on the Garden of Gethsemane before He died. He intercedes. He continues to pray for us at the right hand of the Father.